If you need a Bible, please raise your hand and we'll get one to you. We're going to be in Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9, that is in the New Testament. Acts chapter 9. And we preach or read out of the ESV version. So if you don't have a Bible and we gave you a Bible, you can keep that Bible. That Bible is yours now if you need one. We'll be in ESV if you have the ESV app. Also, if you get the Golden City Church app, it does have an ESV version in the Bible app section. Acts chapter 9. We there? We good? All right, let's start. Verse 1. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven shone around him. And falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, who you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice but seeing no one. Saul rose from the ground, and although his eyes were open, he saw nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And for 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now, there was a disciple at Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias," and he said, "Here I am, Lord." And the Lord said to him, "Rise and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. For behold, he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints at Jerusalem. And there he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias departed and entered the house, and laying his hands on him, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you came, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes and he regained his sight. Then he rose and was baptized, and taking food, he was strengthened. For some days he was with disciples at Damascus, and immediately he proclaimed Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." And all who heard him were amazed and said, "Is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem of those who called upon this name? And has he not come here for this purpose, to bring them bound before the chief priests?" But Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Christ. Verse 23, when many days had passed, the Jews plotted to kill him, but their plot became known to Saul. They were watching the gates day and night in order to kill him, but his disciples took him by night and let him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. And when he had come to Jerusalem, he attempted to join the disciples, and they were all afraid of him, for they did not believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord, who spoke to him, and how at Damascus he had preached boldly in the name of Jesus. So he went in and out among them at Jerusalem, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. And he spoke and disputed against the Hellenists, but they were seeking to kill him. And when the brothers learned this, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was built up, and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. These are God's words. Let's pray. God, it is amazing to see how you take evil and you turn it into good. I pray, Father, that we here in this place, in this moment, would humble themselves, that would listen for a second about this amazing man named Jesus and how he changed the face of the world and history by people just like us. In your name, amen. All right. Let's get right into it. I know I covered a lot, 30 verses. You just went through 30 verses. You're welcome. You did it. You didn't even have to read it, really. I read it for you. You like that? So 30 verses, Acts chapter 9, and now we're in this interesting part. So if you're new, just want to get you caught up a little bit. We've been doing the year of biblical literacy, and what we mean by that is we mean this, that many Christians and many people in general hear a lot of things about Jesus or Christianity, but predominantly it's bumper sticker knowledge or theology. You know, Jesus loves me, or Jesus saves, or all these things. And people look at these things and they're like, okay, whatever. Or you have gone to church your whole life and you've never read the Bible from cover to cover. And maybe you're not a church going type person, and you're not a Christian at all. But I would challenge you and say this: this book has transformed all of our history, that we actually understand and know much, much things through this book, that Jesus is this figure, that there is more books written about Jesus than any other figure in history, more music written about Jesus than any other person in history, more artwork done of Jesus than any other person in history. If you want to realize what the world that you live in, you want to know who this person is, and his name is Jesus. And there is a book that talks about his whole story, that from the beginning to the end, it is all coming to this ultimate ending of Jesus being the one who saves us all. It's the story. And so we've been going through this series called the Year of Biblical Literacy, to where we went from Genesis and now we're in Acts. We went from the Old Testament to the New Testament to understand the story of God, which is this: that God is a God that created the world and everything for a love relationship. That was his mission. His mission is that every single one of us would experience the love of God, and that we actually, this concept of heaven is a world of love, and that is one of the things that we are so inspired by, or when we see glimpses of love, or when we see beautiful things, we say, that is real. You say, I see a lot of hate, I see a lot of violence, I see a lot of ridiculousness in the world, but when you see the beauty of love, you say, that's real. That's something. That's what I know. And this is the thing. That is just an echo. That is a ray coming from the very source of what God is. So God created us, started this whole story, right? God starts and says, God the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, this Trinity, they are in love. And what happens when people are in love and completely whole? They create. And so God creates. He wasn't needing, you know, God wasn't lonely in the cosmos being like, oh man, like I'm bummed out. I'm going to make up Mason so he can play guitar, because then I can listen to Mason play guitar, which wouldn't be that bad of a thing. But that's not the reason why he did it. The reason why, right, God created us, because he was so filled, he was so whole, that he brought into this canvas that we call the cosmos, and he created everything to experience and understand his love and goodness. But here's the thing. We rebelled. We went against him. We say, no, I don't think God knows exactly what I want or how I want to experience love. And so we rebelled in sin, right? We ate of the forbidden fruit. We went our own separate way. And then what ended up happening is sin entered the world. I tell you guys this whole season, because I want us to understand the meta narrative, the huge story of Scripture. Because if you don't understand the whole story of Scripture, you're constantly going to think that book is just a manual of how to be good and not go to hell. And that's not what this book is about. This book is how to live an abundant life, how to be people who bear the same insignia and the same name, whose name is love, who's Jesus Christ, right? So God creates us for a love relationship, and we fall into sin. But this is the crazy thing about sin. Sin not only separates us from God to where we do our own things, but sin separates us from God. It separates you and me from each other. That's why there's war and enemies, and I can't trust you and you can't trust me, because what has sin done? Sin says, I can't really know that you're looking after my good, right? Sin is the antithesis of love. Love is this connecting force that brings us together to know each other and be known by each other. And it's not this superficial Hallmark love. It's a love of being fully known and fully loved, that you are known by God, but simultaneously he wants to love you at the same time. And there's many people that fully know you and are obligated to love you, right? Like your brothers or sisters and stuff like that. Like, I know you. I've known what you've been up to in your life. And yeah, I love you, but I know you. But then there's the other side where you're fully loved, but not really known. You've kept something secret. You've kept something to yourself. But God has always wanted us to be fully known and fully loved. He even says this in the book of John. He says, come into the light as I am in the light. Come and be fully known by me. And no matter how dirty you are, no matter what you have done, come into the light and be known by me. And I'm going to shower you with love. That love is actually the main ingredient. Love is the main engine that actually starts change in one's life. It is not change and then God will love you. It's no. Become loved by God and experience the change that God wants to do in your life. God creates us for a love relationship. We fall into sin. But when we fell into sin, we broke our communion with God, our communion with each other. That's why Adam and Eve, they're like, I don't know if I can really trust you. They had kids, both of their kids, Cain and Abel. Cain ends up killing Abel because his happiness was impeded on by Abel's. And it just keeps on going and it spins out of control. But here's the thing, it's not only between, sin doesn't just separate each other, but it separates even the deepest part of who you are. Because there's a part in you to where you do something wrong and you say, that's not me. But you did it. No, but Josh, that's not me. Jesus says this, he says, a good tree produces good fruit, right? If it's a good and healthy tree that gets the water, gets the sunshine, right? It produces good fruit. A bad tree doesn't produce good fruit, right? It doesn't work that way, okay? And a good tree doesn't produce bad fruit. And this is the thing, you say, Josh, I'm a good person, I just do bad things. No, what sin does is it separates you from your real imago Dei, which is the image of God that gives you value, dignity of worth, that this is the reason why the world isn't in flames right now. And you might be looking at the news right now and being like, oh my gosh, the world's in flames right now. Politically, everything's going crazy. Okay, hold on a second. The government is upon Jesus' shoulders. It is all under his control. You can chill out and know while you're in San Francisco, you don't have to buy a whole bunch of food and a cabin and run up to the cabin and wait for Armageddon to happen. Don't worry. God is in complete control of all of the situation. But here's the deal. Here's the deal. We see that God creates and he says, we are people that are separated from each other, and we are separated from ourselves to where there's good things that I want to do and there's bad things that I do. But there's this thing that even though we were given the image of God, right, that God has created us to be good, and that's why some people are just masters. That's why we have doctors and we have people that go out on and do nonprofit org work, and we see people working and loving, and we see the organization of just what San Francisco is as a city working together, and things aren't going bad. Why? Because it was made in the image of God. It has been marred. It has been broken a little bit by sin, actually massively by sin, but there's still sometimes light that comes through. But we are in a set of sin, and this is the thing now, is that we need to be redeemed. We need to be restored. We can't stay in this place, because not only the world could be a lot worse, but here's the thing. The world could be a lot better. You don't have to look around the world to see the pain and the suffering and the agony. And you could say this, and we all agree, Christians and non-Christians alike, The world's not the way it should be, right? Like you, like some people can just sit down and be like, why is there suffering? Why is there pain? Why is all of these things? And you think to yourself, like, what can I do? And you're like, I'm just one person. I'm just one man. I'm just one woman. I'm just one thing. What can I do? And if there is a God, why doesn't he make a way for the world to be redeemed and renewed? And he does. So this is the part of the story of Scripture. He creates us for a love relationship. We fall into sin. The world becomes broken. But he says, I'm going to use a family, the Israelites, right? And through them, I'm going to bless Abraham. And through that family, the whole world will be blessed. But here's the problem with Abraham's family. They just wanted to be blessed and be left alone. They were isolationists. They're like, bless me, God, and then I'll be over here till you beam me up like Scotty, right? Like, beam me up, Scotty. You know, like that concept. I'll just wait over here as an isolationist, not engage culture, not look for renewal, not wanting to see the city of San Francisco redeemed. I'm just going to do my church thing over here and not engage culture whatsoever. This is what the Desert Fathers did, and it really, really ruined it. We see people run from the cities instead of embrace the cities because, the city of San Francisco, the cities, they're too sinful. But this is what God does. God creates Abraham and his family. He says, I'm going to bless you so that the whole world can be blessed. It can be redeemed. Well, from that redemption came someone named Jesus. And we got to read about him in the Gospels. The good news is this, that he came to fix our relationship between us and God. He came to fix our relationship between you and me. Think about that. Think about that. He says, no greater love that anyone can experience than this, that if someone lays their life down for their friend. He says, you want to know that you are being loved by God? Love one another. You want to know that you are a Christian? The world will know that you are Christians, not by the bumper stickers that you have on your car, not the t-shirts that you wear, not by you not cussing, not by you being a person that is completely morally upright. The world will know that you are Christians by your love for one another. So he starts bringing us together and bringing us to be agents of reconciliation, that we're bringing people that are far away from God to be in redemptive or to be redeemed by God, that we are bringing about this gathering of brothers and sisters from different last names and different backgrounds and just different just cultures, and God brings us together. But not only that, but Jesus says, hey, you are broken, you are filled with sin, I'm going to make you whole. See, you remember I was telling you there's this gap in you, the person that you want to be and the person that you are, and you feel like there's something pulling at both, and Jesus comes and says, I want to redeem that. I want to restore that. I want to heal that. I want to make you, what does he keep on saying? He says, I want to make you whole. Why does he say that? Well, because there's a division that sin has broken you and has made you double-minded, saying, I want to be this way or I want to be that way. And he says, I want to make you whole. And then we know this, that we have this future hope and this understanding that one day God will come, rule and reign, and he will restore this earth. Right? What does he say? He says, when you pray, pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We are starting to do that now. So that is the story, and quickly I want to look through what we are looking through today, which is Acts chapter 9. We have 3 points. Watch the time, welcome the stranger, and witness the multiplication. Watch the time, welcome the stranger, and witness the multiplication. First, there's a story in the book by C.S. Lewis called The Screwtape Letters. Have you guys heard of The Screwtape Letters? It's a really fascinating book. It's basically this leader of this, it's fictional, okay? This is a fictional book. This is not canon. This is not, nonfiction. But C.S. Lewis, a great writer, he writes this book about a a group of demons, and one demon is like this lieutenant demon, and he's writing to a younger demon, I think it's his nephew, and he's writing to his to this younger demon of how to trap up and trip up Christians. And it's a really interesting book because you always think of demons being like, you know, Halloween's coming around and it's scary and, you know, boo and whatever. But Screwtape Letters is more like this. Screwtape Letters is like this intellectual thing that the demons are not trying to scare you or spook you, but the demons are cool and calculated and strategic. And it's, if you want like a quick read, but it's like, whoa, this is packs a punch, read it. It's called The Screwtape Letters by C.S. Lewis. But there's a story in it, and it says this. There's a legend about Satan and his imps planning their strategy for attacking the world that's hearing the message of salvation. One of the demons says, I've got a plan, Master. When I get on earth and take charge of people's thinking, I will tell them that there is no heaven. The devil responds, ah, they'll never believe that. This book of truth is full of messages about the hope of heaven through sins forgiven. They won't believe that. They know there's a glory yet future. On the other side of the room, another says, I've got a plan. I'll tell them there's no hell. And he goes, no good, he says. Jesus, while he was on earth, talked more of hell than of heaven. They know in their hearts that their wrong will have to be taken care of in some way. They deserve nothing more than hell. And then one brilliant little imp in the back stood up and said, then I know the answer. I'll just tell them that there's no hurry. And he's the one Satan chose. See, this is the great lie that really gets into the vitality and the multiplication and the vigor of the church. There's no hurry. There's no hurry. And I'm not talking about a spiritual hurry to where you're like, I need to do all of these things. But for the spreading of the gospel, for the spreading of the news, for the scattering that God has called us to do, we say, I'll do that when I'm older. I'll get serious about God later on in life. I will start talking about my own personal sanctification and my own personal character later. There's no hurry. And I think this is a very, very huge thing that the early church had to deal with. Why do I think that? Well, I think that for a couple reasons. Let's just look at this very beginning of verse 1. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Okay, this is really interesting. So this is right, we had to kind of go past the story of Stephen, who was the first martyr that kind of went in front of the high priest and all of these people, and he said that he saw Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and he and Paul, or Saul at that time, that was his name, was there, and he held all the coats while people stoned the first martyr, Stephen. But we look at this powerful and interesting beginning, and we see that there is already opposition towards the church coming from their own countrymen. Because you have to see this, that the Jews and the high priests and the Pharisees, they believed that the Christians were a heretical bunch of people. They believed that the Christians believed in the Trinity, God the Father, the Son, the Spirit, that they believed in this new Messiah that came to take away the sins of the world. And we see Saul saying, we need to push them out. We need to destroy them. As they are called to scatter into the rest of the world, we need to grab them, bind them, and bring them back. So we see this at the very beginning. See, at Acts chapter 1, verse 6, it said this. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? This is right before he ascends. And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will become my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. We see in the Gospels where he says, go into all the earth and preach the gospel. See, this is the thing that we have to understand. You will, when you read scripture, you'll see a lot of patterns. And the reason why you'll see a lot of patterns is God is trying to wake you up and get you to understand what he's doing when it comes to his mission. We were talking about this, that God does not have a mission for the church. He has a church for his mission. Okay? God does not have a mission for his church. He has a church for his mission. He has always been going out and trying to grab people to understand the love of God. But when we see at the very beginning with the first Adam, what was he supposed to do? God creates the first Adam, creates Eve, and he says, I want you to go and be fruitful and multiply. Noah, be fruitful and multiply. I want you to scatter and I want you to grow out this world. What do we see? Well, God breathes in new life, right? He breathes in new life in Acts, the Holy Spirit. He becomes a man, right? And then we actually saw this beautiful aspect of God healing and creating a new temple and a new family. But now we see God giving the commission again. Go into all the world. Go into all the world. But this time, don't just have families, do that as well, but go and win souls for God. He creates a new thing and a new call for us. And he says, I want you to wait. And once the Holy Spirit comes, then go to Jerusalem, then go to Judea, then go to Samaria, and then go to the four corners of the world. Now, here's the thing for you guys in San Francisco. What happens when the four corners of the world move to San Francisco? Go to San Francisco. You stay in San Francisco. I'm not trying to tell you that you need to stay here forever. I'm not trying to say that. God's going to call you to go. But I will say this is an interesting thing because of modern technology, is that when God calls us to go to the four corners of the earth, we go. But what happens when the four corners of the earth starts coming to our cities? And this is a crazy thing. In the 80s and 90s, many Christians moved away from cities. They left the cities. The families left the cities. It's too bad down there. And what happened is it became a place where it was incredibly unchurched. But the first thing that we must do is we have to watch the time, and we know that the Holy Spirit has fallen and we must scatter. We also see that the hostility increased. It said in Luke 21, 12 through 19, it said, but before all this, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors for my name's sake. This will be your opportunity to bear witness. Settle it therefore in your minds and not meditate beforehand how to answer, for I will give you a mouth and wisdom which none of your adversaries will be able to withstand and contradict. You will be delivered up even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and some of you they will put to death. You will be hated by all for my name's sake, but not a hair of your head will perish, but your endurance you will gain your lives. We see this concept of Jesus saying, hey, to the disciples, he says, there's going to be a much persecution, but keep on going. And persecution brings about this concept and this reality that we must go, that there is some sort of a urgency to win souls for Christ. In the early church, they were thinking, man, if they kill all of us, how is it going to spread to the rest of the world? We must go now. And I'm sure that there was comforts that were creeped upon, especially as they were becoming incredibly generous with one another, and they were bringing all of their food, and they were bringing all of their wealth, and they were bringing all the things, and if there was any sick among them, they were brought in to the family of God. So in this passage of scripture, we see a couple things. We see that we have to watch the time, for the days are evil. It says in the scripture, redeem the time, be urgent. Watch the time of when to scatter, when to move, when to go. Maybe you today, you're thinking, man, where is God calling me next? And that doesn't mean just a geographical location. Sometimes that's a place that God's calling you. Man, God's calling me to be more available to other people. God is calling me to be more generous. God is calling me to be a certain place, that there's not only an outward journey that takes place in the life of Christians, but an inward journey. That's why I strongly suggest that if you're thinking of taking an outward journey, read The Lord of the Rings. I promise you, it is a great thing, and that is from the very top right here, right? at Golden City Church, if you're going on an outward journey, read Lord of the Rings because it will prepare you for this quest that you'll be able to go on. If you're going to go on an inward journey in literature, read Dostoevsky. This guy that just thinks deep into like who he really is in an inward journey. I say these things because it is a thing that we are called to think. Christians are called to think out their implications. We're not called to take a part of their mind and just throw it out of the door and say, this is the thing. But God calls us to read and study and learn. So we see that we must watch the time. Time is short. Paul is coming for us, and the gospel must scatter. It says that he said to his disciples, Jesus answered them, do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming indeed. It has come when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me, and I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulations, but take heart, I have overcome the world. This scattering, this bringing us about, this type of loneliness, these things that will come, this was not something that was just a random thing, and you're like, becoming a Christian, then having to leave. Jesus is like, no, you're going to have tribulations. People are going to come after you. And I will tell you this, tribulation is not you having to comment somebody back on Facebook because they believe in a different candidate than you, okay? You're not being full with tribulation and things online. That is not what he's talking about. But we do this all the time. We're getting tribulated. We need to go back. You know what? God is in complete control. And this is the thing. If you can't have peace when it comes to Facebook comments, how are you going to have peace when it comes to true tribulation? God is calling you to, in every season of life, experience peace. And I know it's hard because we have rights in America. I totally believe that. But for the Christian, we have died and we are called to be servants. Servants to the least of our brothers. God says, to whoever you do, whatever you do unto the least, you've done it unto me. So he calls us to welcome and or watch the time. But secondly, we are called to welcome the stranger. So we see in this right off the way, now as he went on his way, he approached Damascus and suddenly a light shone off from heaven around him and falling to the ground. And he heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting? Okay, so Saul, think of this guy. Saul is this theological master in Judaism. He is this man that is so zealous and ambitious and wants to just make sure that this Christian sect just gets snuffed out. He is so ambitious and his life is filled with such purpose. I love Saul, and this is the reason why many people here, we have to understand this. We have idols in our lives, and we have to be able to point out the idols in our lives, but not only that, but we have to be able to hear the noise that comes and emanates from the idols. Here's the idol that we see in this portion of scripture, and this is what I want you to think through with me right now. The idols of our life is something that is an image that we see that we try to protect. Anything that is more important that gives you life or strength or anything more than Jesus is an idol, right? It's your epithemia. It's your greatest good. If something, it could be not just a bad thing, could be an idol. Good things can be an idol as well. Any type of good thing that becomes an ultimate thing is a bad thing. It's an idol. My sweet little Lola and my beautiful wife Shay, they are, oh, I love them so much and I will do anything for them. And it reminds me of the song by Keith Green. I always say this. He has a song called I Pledge My Head to Heaven. He goes, I pledge my head to heaven for the gospel. Right? And he says, I pledge my wife to heaven for the gospel. And every single day I see her, our love just seems to grow. But I told her when we wed, I surely rather be found dead than to love her more than the one who saved my soul. And then he has this other part where he talks about his son. He goes, I pledge my son to heaven for the gospel, even though he is scorned and ridiculed at school. I will teach him to rejoice and with a thankful saving voice, that he could suffer like the one who wore this crown of thorns. He talks about this and he goes throughout all of his life and he says, I'm pledging this person to heaven. I'm pledging this thing to heaven and saying, you are more glory. I love you so much, but God's glory is so much greater. Jesus is of so much more value than that. But here's the thing. Anything that you make a ultimate thing, more than Jesus, becomes an idol, and noise comes from those things. So I would say in this portion of Scripture, the reason why we don't scatter, the reason why we don't go after the Great Commission of what God has called us to do is this. Our life. My life. See, in Christianity, Jesus says, when I have become the substitutionary atonement, when I gave up and sacrificed my life for you, it says, if any man come after me, let him deny himself. Take up his cross and follow me. If you were to try to find your life, lose your life, gain my life, switch with me. But this is the thing. Many Christians, we come in here and we say, Christianity is kind of an extension of who I am. It is not necessarily my life. It's just an extension of what I do. It's a hobby. It's not my life. And Jesus says, that's not how it works. It does not work that way. And so many times the idol of my life, noises get pushed out. Okay, so if the idol in this portion is my life, let's look at Saul's life. Saul is a man that is ambitious towards the law, that this is his life's goal, that if you looked on his LinkedIn account, he's like, I was a Hebrew among Hebrews. Not only my mother was a Hebrew, but also my father was a Hebrew. Not only that, but Gamaliel taught me. He put that up, and he's like, I have one connection. If you don't know what LinkedIn is, on social media, Instagram's like 30,000. You're like, hey, look at this. Look how great I am. All of my pictures are awesome. But Saul just says, my purpose and my ambition is to be great. That is my value. That is my great thing. And I'm going to do that with everything I can. When you move to San Francisco, many of you are ambitious and you want to take the world and you want to go after it. And that's a good thing. But if it becomes everything to you, if it becomes your ultimate, then it is an idol. And guess what? Idols always disappoint their worshipers. Always over-deliver, or they over-promise, and they always under-deliver. Always. So we see Saul, and he's going after him, and his plans of being the best Pharisee Jew that ever was is about to get squashed. By who? By the resurrected Lord Jesus. He foils the plans greatly. What do we see? We see this. He was on his way and he heard and he fell down, hearing a voice saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who was Saul truly persecuting? Was he persecuting the church? Jesus was saying, you are persecuting the risen Lord. And he goes, who are you, Lord? And the word Lord there isn't master, it's sir. It's an interesting translation there. And he said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting, but rise and enter the city and you will be told what you are to do. And the men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice but seeing no one. How about that? Paul seems like he's crazy. They heard a voice and they're like, something happened, but they didn't see anyone. The men who were with him were speechless. Saul rose from the ground and although his eyes were opened, he saw nothing. I love that. His eyes were open that he has experienced the person that he was persecuting, but he can't see. I love that. And know this, you might be able to see with your eyes and think that you're so wise and stuff like that, but God says that you are blind. You're blind to actually seeing what you are actually here for, the purpose of your life. And so you see Saul right off the bat, a person that is ambitious, a person that wants to make sure wrongdoings don't happen. He's a young and zealous man for the truth, but Saul explains his devotion and dogmatism towards the law of God. He wasn't just zealous. He was a man that was measuring his life by everyone else, saying, you're not good enough, you're not good enough, you're not good enough. He was ambitious. And then we're introduced to a new man, Ananias. Now, here's the crazy thing. God has this way of people that have done wrong things in the Bible, and he redeems their names. I don't know why he does that, but he does. And so we see with Ananias, the first one, Ananias and Sapphira, who they faked him. They said that they sold everything they had, but they only gave a part. And then they lied to the Holy Spirit, and they were struck down, right? So that was the first Ananias, the liar. Right? But then God redeems the name of Ananias. And what does he say? Ananias, this man that is in Damascus, I want you to go to meet a man named Saul. And he's like, wait a second, hold up. Heard of this guy? Saul kills people like me. God, are you sure this is your voice speaking to me? I've heard of this guy. Now, here's the thing with Ananias. Ananias is in Damascus. He's already left. This is the thing that you have to understand. The gospel didn't go viral online to where someone, it happened in Jerusalem, and then it like showed up in Damascus. The only probable explanation for Ananias to be in Damascus is he was there in the upper room when the Spirit fell and God said to go into all the world, and he started going. Right? God, you did such an amazing work. I'm going to go out to Damascus. And he runs out to Damascus to preach the word. And then he's like, man, I took a step of faith. I'm doing really good. God, you told me to take a step of faith. I'm taking a step of faith. And he's like, Ananias, that's great. I want you to meet Saul. And he's like, huh? Like, ruh-roh, like what? Like you want me to meet the Christian killer, the one that kills the people of the way. Like, am I hearing you right? When is the last time that God has asked you to go out on a limb to maybe not kill you physically, but maybe kill your street cred or kill something that you say, man, this will socially take me down a peg if I invite this person to church or I invite this person or I speak to them in a different level. It might ruin my street cred a little bit. Ananias already took, God, I already took a step of faith. My family's probably in Jerusalem, but hey, I'm going to take a step of faith and I'm going to go to Damascus. And then God says, hey, Ananias, you have been faithful in the small things. Now I'm going to make you faithful in the big things. I want you to go and preach to the Christian assassin, Saul. He goes, God, what? How is this true? And I'm sure Ananias had his comforts. He probably wanted to keep his life. He probably thought he was going crazy. Really, I've heard of this guy named Saul, the first martyr, Stephen, got killed by being stoned to death. I don't want to see it happen to me. How easy would it have been for Ananias to say, God, I've already done a lot for you. I moved to Damascus. I've already done a lot for you, God. I don't think I should go and lay hands on Saul, who will then later on turn Paul, and he writes a third of the New Testament. God, I don't feel like I'm up to it. I've already done a lot of good things in your name. Don't ask me to do more than that. Sometimes when we say it's my life, one of the things, I was talking to a brother this week, and I said, one of the biggest lies that you can ever say to yourself, I want you to listen to this. One of the biggest lies that you can say to yourself is this. I deserve this. I deserve this. I know you've worked hard week, and you know what? You've worked a hard week, and you could say, man, I just don't want to go either to church today, I don't want to go to community group today, or God, I don't want to serve, I don't want to read the Bible, it's just too early in the morning. God, I have things that I could do and pray. I deserve this time alone. I deserve it. And Jesus says, do you not know that you are bought with a price, that I have sacrificed my own life for you? That will you live this life for me, because I died the death for you? But this lie that keeps on going in our head. Many of you struggling with sin, and maybe you've just been patient with a person for way too long. You're like, I have let them say things to me and do things to me for way too long, Josh. I'm just going to let them have it because I deserve it. I'm tired and sick and tired of being stepped on like a mat, and I'm just going to let them have it. I deserve this. That is one of the most damaging sins to not only people in the church, but pastors as well. I know so many pastors that have been serving God for years that have fallen in ministry. Why? Because for a moment, I deserve this. I've been serving God for 30 years. I deserve this, whatever it is. And God is calling us to say, I've been bought with a price. And we see this to welcome the stranger. We see Ananias and he goes in there and he says, brother, he calls him Brother Saul, will you receive your sight? Ananias, he goes in and he says, here I am, Lord. Rise, go to the street called the Straight at the house of Judas. Look for a man named Tarsus, of Tarsus named Saul, for behold, he is praying, and he has seen a vision of a man named Ananias come in, lay his hands on him, so that he might regain his sight. Okay, so let me give you a break from all this theology and biblical stuff, okay? Saul, for sake of illustration, is KD. Okay, you guys know who KD is? Kevin Durant? You know who Kevin Durant is? He gave us a really, really hard time, the Warriors, that is, not us, Golden City Church, but the Golden State Warriors, right? Gave us a really hard time last year during the playoff season, right? KD sinking things, Westbrook doing all of these things, and if we can't beat him, which we did, right? He couldn't beat us, so what did he do? He joined us, right? Well, think of Saul. Saul is this superstar in the Jewish community. He knows Hebrew in the original language. I mean, think of Saul's pedigree versus Peter, the fisherman, right? Like, Peter's writing, like, they actually say in the book, of, in First and Second Peter, in the original documents, many theologians say that it's really hard to decipher Peter's Greek because he wrote in really big letters. And I just love that. I love that because it's amazing, right? It's like this real thing. And then when you look at Saul, Saul's using all of this Greek and he's messing around and doing all of these like beautiful alliterations and like putting into all of these figures and stuff like that. And you're just like, man, God, you use all different types of people. You use the fisherman Peter and you use the brilliant theologian Paul all for your glory. And I see this and I say, it's an amazing thing that we see this man that was going after the church and we could get scared of him. But God says, I'm going to take this evil and I'm going to turn it for good. And this man is going to not only help build the church, but many people will know him. 2,000 years later, are we not glad that Ananias listened to the call of God, went to that house and prayed over him and called him what? Brother Saul. What other religion, what other thing could take an enemy and make them friends? God is calling us to see this great and amazing thing. Ananias could have had comforts and he didn't. We look at the disciples. Man, it's so funny. Saul becomes a Christian. He goes into Jerusalem, right? And it says the disciples are afraid of him, right? Okay, we see Ananias, not even a disciple, not even an apostle. Okay, God, I'm going to go and pray for him. Praise for him, right? He goes right away. Saul just starts preaching it. And he goes, I see it clearly. I've seen the whole Old Testament. It's been missing the key ingredient. It's all about Jesus. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. And he can't help it. He's a teacher. And he just lets it out into the streets of Damascus, and people are getting after him. Then he goes to Jerusalem. He's like, I can't wait to meet the disciples, right? I could just imagine Paul just amped up, ready to meet the disciples, and the disciples are like, I don't want to meet him. I don't, like, how do we know he's not a double agent? Like, how do we know he's not, like, spying on them to kill us and find our base and all of these things? It almost sounds like a Star Wars and the Rebellion and all of these things. It's like, you know, like, should we really have this guy come in? And so he ends up coming in, and this is what I love. It says, but Barnabas goes in and tells all of them, like, he's legit, too legit to quit. Okay, he is, sorry for that, he is totally a Christian. Okay, Barnabas, his name means son of encouragement. I want to tell you about Barnabas because Barnabas is one of my favorite people. If we have a son and Shay doesn't veto it, which it will probably be vetoed because it's not that fancy of a name, I love Barnabas. Barnabas, the son of encouragement. Why? Because Barnabas is the first Christian to sell all of his stuff. He actually owned land. He sells everything that he has and lays it at the disciples' feet. He says, I've been bought at such a price. I'm going to take all I have and just sell it, and I'm going to be a missionary for Jesus. Barnabas was the first person to do it. Ananias and Sapphira gets like the glory for it, right? Because they were the ones that die and all these things. But it was actually Barnabas who they were copying. Now get this. Barnabas has nothing to lose. He already sold everything he had. He's already in mission to God, for God. He sees Saul. He knows all the disciples are scared of him. He's like, you know what? I have nothing to lose. What? Is he going to kill my life? I'll go to heaven. The disciples are scared. And Barnabas is like, let's do this thing. Tell me your story, Saul. Okay, so you're on the thing. Jesus says, why are you persecuting me? It checks out. It checks out. Look at this. A man or woman who has nothing to lose. A man or woman who has nothing to lose. Why? Because Jesus has given them eternal life. A person that is not afraid to lose is one of the most dangerous people in the world. Why? We look at Paul's life. To live is Christ, to die is gain. What? You can't speak and praise Jesus in the streets and talk about Jesus? We're going to put you in prison. Fine. Paul's like, fine, put me in prison. Then he starts saving all of these jail people in there, and he's like, we're not going to let him in there. You know, throw him out there. And they're like, well, this is what we'll do. We'll stone him to death. Fine. Stone me to death. He goes down. He dies. Guess what ends up happening? God raises him from the dead. More people come into the church. He's like, what's going on? And this is the thing. When people start getting rid and becoming incredibly generous what they have, and they become more and more people of things, or understanding that there is nothing to lose, and they give up more and more of their idols, and they start making Jesus the greatest thing, it becomes this incredible thing. Because Jesus has won, we are free to lose. I'm going to say that again. Because Jesus has won and has given us life everlasting, you're free to lose. That should take so much weight off of your shoulders, because all of us are in this rat race, right? We're all trying to win. We're all trying to get to the highest point. We're all trying to be the best or doing all these things. And we keep on doing it, and we put these huge trips on ourselves. But this is the thing. Because Jesus has won, you can lose. And you say, all of my life is to Jesus. You know what? You want that promotion so bad? I'm not going to fight you for it. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to cheat you out of something. Go ahead. Look and be a Barnabas, the son of encouragement. How much do we need to be that to the world in San Francisco? We see the church, it was young, but it was messy, it was complex, it was scared and completely relying on the Holy Spirit. We see Barnabas being compassionate and doing what others wouldn't. He was merciful. Mercy is what? Responding to others' misery. Saul wanting to meet the disciples, and the disciples don't want to meet Saul. Barnabas comes along, grabs him by the neck, and he says, you're one of us. Come on in, brother. God is going to make many come to know through you. He gave us his land. He gave of his life. What else could they take? See, we serve a king that is greater. So I say this, you have heard it said that your life is no longer your own. But I say this, if your purpose in life is not bending its knee to God's glory, if your life is about extensions and comforts and you're not surrendered, if your life is not a vessel to which the water of life can flow through, you are not worshiping. If you're scattering, right, as you're going throughout the world, is in your control or a part of your plan, you aren't understanding how Jesus planted you in the place you are. If your life is falling apart and you're freaking out, do you believe this, even though your life is no longer your own anymore because you've become a Christian, do you believe this, that Jesus actually cares and has a plan? It is not a mistake that you are here at Golden City Church in San Francisco today on Sunday. It is not a mistake. God is filling you up to go out and be a blessing. And guess what? All you are called to be is a witness. What does a witness do? Tells the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God. You don't have to be super strategic or theological. All you say is, I was once blind and now I see. I've been loved so greatly by Christ, now I can love others. Do you see that? When God frees you of the idolatry in our hearts, when God frees you from the idols that everybody else is trying to hold on to so greatly, if you just let them go, God says, as you scatter into the whole world, you're going to be an exile. You're going to be someone that feels lonely at times. But get this, you are never alone, because it says Jesus Christ is with you, and he is with you to the end of the age. Life now, no matter how great it is right now for you stays the same. If we are at a good point or a bad point, we know it's temporary. However, life is not about the high point or the low. Your life is about the one you love and who has your life. And today, God is saying, as you're scattering into the whole world, as you experience persecution, as you experience conversion, as we see with Saul, to where his life was all set. He was ambitious. He was like, I'm just going to take down all of these so-called Christians and I'm going to establish my own kingdom. And Jesus says, what you are going to do for evil, I am turning for good. Now, Kevin Durant is on the Warriors, praise God. And this is what we see with Paul, right? We see Saul. God changes his name to Paul. And he transforms it. So the first thing that we learn today, right, is we have to watch the time. We have to know that God is redeeming time. Secondly, we welcome in the stranger. Why? Why can we welcome in people into the family of God? Because God has given his own Father to us. He has loved us. He has bought us with such a great price. And then lastly, we see witness the multiplication. Acts 9:31, lastly. So this church throughout all of Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and the comfort of the Holy Spirit and multiplied. Okay, now this is what I want to say. Many people say, I can't wait till persecution comes, brother. I can't wait. All these Christians here in San Francisco, I don't know why these Christian brothers always sound like Hulk Hogan, but they do. I can't wait till persecution comes, because when persecution comes, that's when the church really grows. Well, that's not what it says in the Bible. The Bible says that after this time happened, peace became out throughout the land for a while, and it started growing. And here's the thing. God is about this liturgy of scattering his people and then gathering his people and scattering his people and gathering his people, that our whole lives and our church becomes this great reunion. Have you ever been to a great reunion? I have a grandfather who is Italian who has 15 brothers and sisters. Okay, we had a family reunion, and there's this huge park in Huntington Beach. It's called the Huntington Beach Park. Fitly name, and the whole place was covered with this family called the Ventis. And I know, like the coffee drink, right? Ventis, right? Or the coffee size, right? And it was covered, and I got to see all these families. And my grandpa was the seventh son, Giuseppe Venti, right? And he was the seventh son. And there was just kids and kids. And it's so funny how we're gathered through all the world. We're scattered throughout the world, but on that day we all came together, and that is what the church is called to be, this great gathering together and scattering in all the world, right? This has been said, I said this the other day at small group, is that, you know, Christians are supposed to be like manure, right? You're like, what? That's gross. No, Christians are supposed to be like manure. When they're gathered together too much, it starts to really stink. But when it's scattered into the world, it actually does good and it grows things well. It becomes a wellspring of life, and that is what we are called to do. We are called to witness the multiplication. That multiplication is not a bad thing, but we need to watch and see this is how God's doing it. If God grows Golden City Church, it's not going to be by me. It's not going to be by a tool, right? It's not going to be by Gloria. Maybe by Gloria, okay? Maybe by Gloria, the prayer warrior. But it's not going to be by us. It's going to be by his Spirit. And it says this, walking in the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, knowing and saying, I'm not going to have my idols high up. God, I don't fear man. I fear you. And in the comfort of the Holy Spirit. There's this idea of walking in the challenge of God, but also being comforted by the Holy Spirit, that we witness the church multiply. If my life is now Christ's, then I can rest assured that he will make something beautiful and useful with it. Our vocation, our wealth, our health, our relationships, our emotions, all of these things are canvases in which Jesus makes something beautiful with it. So here's the thing. When I'm telling you guys that Jesus has taken your life, you're saying, so Josh, can I not have a good career, or I can't have ambition. No, no, no. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying whatever your vocation is, whatever your job is, whatever your money or wealth is, whatever your health is, whatever your relationship, whatever your emotions, your life is a canvas into which God wants to make something beautiful of. Some of you guys are in high places to where you have an awesome opportunity to love and live where you are out, but you are a canvas for God to paint on it for His glory. Maybe you have talent with music. Maybe you are actually an artist and God is saying, I want you to live a life to where your life is a canvas for my work. We have yet to see the beauty He will make of our lives. Let us trust Him. See this. As Jesus' cross was the canvas that portrayed our forgiveness, as Jesus' abandonment on the cross was the canvas that portrayed our acceptance, as Jesus' homelessness was the canvas that portrayed our heavenly home, our scattering provides for some lost souls hope for gathering together when we are at that eternal shore. Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you so much for who you are and how kind you are to us, sinners. God, you want us to experience your truth. You want us to watch the time of when to go out, when to scatter, when to leave our places. You want us to welcome the stranger, that there is going to be times to where we don't want to welcome people that are not like us, but you have called us to love everyone. That they are a moment away from being a brother or sister of Christ. I pray that we would be like Barnabas, sons of encouragement, who gives away of their idols, of their things that they're holding on to more than you, so that they would be freely able to open up their arms to the stranger. And then I pray, Lord, that we can witness the multiplication, the work that you want to do in San Francisco, not our work, not by our power, not by our prayers, but by the power of Jesus Christ that saves sinners, that empowers believers. That is through the times, whether of persecution or peace, it is through fearing God rather than fearing man. It's through being comforted through the power of the Holy Spirit. God, many of us today have not let go of idols. Many of us has not surrendered our own lives to you. We have given our lives to lesser things. And God, you are calling us today to surrender everything to you, that our life is no longer our own, but it's been bought with a price. That you'll take care of us, that you love us. You said, how much more valuable are you than the sparrows, and I see each one that falls. I'll care for you. Go out into all the world. Preach the gospel. Scatter around. We thank you. We praise you for this time of worship. Thank you for this time of communion in remembrance of you. Amen.